Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
What time is it, Bob?
Right on time.
That's what I got, Bob.
9:00.
We'd like to welcome each and every one of you to this morning's meeting. And before we get started, if we bow our heads, I'd like to give our invocation, please. Our Heavenly Father, we are indeed a blessed nation. As we have celebrated another Independence Day, help us to remember our struggles and those who continue to fight to keep America free, as we sometimes take our freedom for granted. We are indeed blessed to live in Alamance County, and guide us this morning, our Father, to make the right decisions for our citizens. We are indeed blessed to serve, free to vote, and fortunate to live in a democracy. Grant your blessings in this county, in this country, and we give all the glory to you. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
First item on the agenda is public comments. And we had one individual, Stuart Smith, signed up. And I don't know, we do have a public hearing on the incentives issue, and I don't know if that's what you wanted to address, but we will get to that in just a moment. Okay? I may have to excuse myself a little early this morning. I'm a pallbearer at Andy Motzinger's funeral. Andy hired me in 1973, and I worked for him for 20 years prior to his retirement. So he's a dear friend, and the family asked me to serve, and the funeral is this morning. So depending on the length of the meeting, I'll probably have to turn it over to Vice Chairman Engel to conduct the balance of the meeting. So if you see me get up and leave, that's the reason. First issue this morning is our public hearing on our economic development project. Mac Williams from the Chamber is here to make the presentation. All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, my name is Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce, and it's been my pleasure over the last couple of months to be working with a local company looking to make an expansion. Sandvik is located in Mebane. They have been over there for about 30 years. And over that course of that time have been an excellent corporate citizen, employing people. They are currently employ about 160 folks, making tools and tooling for the metal cutting industry. Sandvik is based in Sweden. They're a global, worldwide company. And we've been fortunate to have them operating in Alamance County for these last several decades. And now they're in an expansion mode. And the facility in Alamance County is a consideration for where to put this expansion. As to the impact of that expansion, rather than me make the presentation about what the numbers are and the more detail, I'm going to have two representatives who are here with the company to do that speaking. We have John Taylor, who is the quality control director. We have John Barber, who is the general manager of the local Mebane facility. And so I think without further ado, I will turn it over to Mr. Taylor, who may have more detail to share with you. And then if you need to come back around to me, I'll be happy to respond. So, Mr. Taylor.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is John Taylor. I've been with Sandvik for about 30 years, so I've been there since it started. And we do have a few facts and figures about our project that we're planning the expansion in Mebane. So I'll try to get that started. A little bit about the details. We do have sales of 55 billion, and that's in Swedish kronor. So the exchange rate, since we're international, is about 6-1. We do have 38,000 employees represented in 130 countries. The products that we have represent a very high R&D value for our customers. We are very much considered a global leader in the areas that we manufacture. Our chairman is Mr. Hedstrom, and the president and CEO is Lars Pedersen. He actually worked in the States for 3 years about 10 years ago. As you can see, we're quite an old company. In 1868, it was started in Sweden. And they work on high value added products for our customers. Again, R&D is a key focus for the products that we manufacture in Mebane, as well as the other products within our organization. The significance of the 4% of invoice sales that we invest in R&D is, the significance of that is it's double what our competitors are doing. So that's what drives our growth. And we do have 2,200 employees in R&D with 4,300 patents worldwide. We have three business groups, core business areas that we, in our organization, the Sandvik Tooling Group, the Sandvik Mining and Construction, such things as road construction, oil drilling, bits for that, and the Sandvik Materials Technology is in steel, strip steel for razor blades. They're into heart stents and also into implants. The tooling group, the Sandvik Tooling Group, is the area that we are, is our business group. As you can see, that's the footprint of our locations throughout the world. I mean, you can see it spread out through the industrialized part very heavily. Sandvik Tooling is the one that we're located in Mebane as part of our group. And you can see we're dealing with metalworking products, and we manufacture about 5,000 different line items in our facility. Now these sites that you see here are not only the sites of Sandvik, they are the tooling sites that manufacture similar products to what we manufacture here in Mebane. And you can see our name in that picture. We have to do cost comparative analysis on manufacturing for all of these sites to see which one is the most favorable. That's why we put all the things in the, that are considered to be favorable for the Mebane location. This is our site in Mebane. We've been there, as Max said, since 1979. So we've been there for quite some time. We had one expansion in 2001. We did not have incentives at that time. It was a minor expansion compared to what we're doing now. We manufacture standard and special tools in our plant in Mebane. The standard tools are tools that you can get out of a catalog. If you can visualize a Sears Roebuck catalog, it's about that thick, and it contains a lot of different technical items used in the metalworking industry. The special tools are used in aerospace and automotive and heavy metalworking equipment like Caterpillar and so forth. It requires a lot of hands-on, the special tools do, as well as engineering capabilities. Every tool has to be engineered, so they're engineered specials. A lot of engineering resources. Currently we have 75,000 square feet of manufacturing space with 13,000 of office. We are a three-shift operation, and it's 5 and 6 days a week currently. So you can see we don't have any room for capacity or any extra capacity, since we're already on a three-shift operation. We do have a flow group concept, which is called a self-directed work team, where the team is responsible for the entire process. The average length of service is 12 years. And the reason it's down to 12 is because of our last expansion, we have added a lot of new people and have kind of averaged that down. We do have 160 people, 120 hourly, and 40 salary. We are certified to ISO 9001, 14001, and 18001. That's a quality, environmental, health and safety standard. It's an international standard represented throughout the world. Again, we are a global supplier. 35% of the products that we make in Mebane are for the global market, as opposed to the 65% for the domestic market. We have a state-of-the-art manufacturing equipment and processes that we utilize in our organizations. And it requires a lot of technical competence in order to be able to operate this equipment and manufacture our products. Our current four-year proposal to be considered is to expand by 54,000 square feet, grow the staff by nine for staff by nine and production personnel by 42 through 2011. With capital investments of 15 to 20 million per year for the manufacturing equipment. And I have a few slides, a future slides that show that a little bit. Graphically, this is a picture or footprint of where we are today. The light area, our pink area there, is our current facility. The dark red is our proposed expansion. And we are required to expand this facility this amount in order to meet the demands if we're going to do this in Mebane. It'll be one of the locations that we've set aside or shown earlier that would get this expansion. So we put together our package, and this is the amount of area that we would need to expand, which would require us, because of the building codes, to allow for pervious and impervious surfaces, we need to have additional property. So the adjacent property on the left, in this area over here, is the adjacent property which we will have to purchase in order to be able to expand and maintain this pervious to impervious ratio. This adjacent property has significant geological challenges. One of them is the elevation, which would require us to bring in considerable amounts of fill to bring it up to the level that we need to keep it on the same level. And as you can see, it looks like a nice stream flowing through there, which is really a drainage ditch is what it is. But it's considered by the EPA to be an intermittent stream, I believe is what they call it. And therefore, you have to have a 50-foot buffer on either side of it. So we, in effect, have to purchase land that we can't use during this particular expansion. So that's the general footprint. And the estimated cost is going to be in excess of $10 million to purchase the land and also to increase the size of the building. Our capital equipment needed to fill this particular space, we'll have to phase it in over the 3 years, because the time to when you purchase it to the time you receive it is somewhere between 9 months to a year and a half, depending on the complexity of the equipment. So you can see that's why we have it spaced out over the 4 years. Along with that comes additional personnel in order to operate and maintain this equipment. So we would have the average wage, as you can see there, it's around $20.30 today, with increases that we calculate in at 3.5%. So we're phasing those in because of the equipment deliveries. You don't need the folks until you actually have the equipment on site, or a little bit before you have the equipment on site. You can see a scheduled increase in personnel. Our employee benefits, maybe we won't go through all of them, but they're pretty standard. The paid time off, or what we used to call vacation time now, paid time off, is determined on the length of service. We do have educational assistance, tuition reimbursement, which is used quite frequently by employees. And the last one there, the performance incentive paid quarterly. Our aim there is they get, our employees get an incentive based upon how well they do their job. And our aim is for them to have at least 1 week's pay every quarter. So it would be an extra month's pay basically, at the end of the year. And it depends on how well they're doing. And so with that, we are asking for financial incentives to help us locate this expansion in Beverly.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor, for that presentation. Mr. Barber, you got any comments?
Yes. I'd just like to say a couple of words. Myself been with SAMIC for 12 years, and SAMIC is a global company. We're continually benchmarking against our own internal competition. And over the past several years, we've been very fortunate to improve our business and be more of a global supplier. This expansion comes after many years of work from our local employees, and is a great opportunity for us in the area. And we believe with the expansion, we can provide a lot of training and a lot of cooperation with the local education. Today, we work very closely with Alamance Community College and support the machine shop program, and this will help us continue to do that. So, thank you.
Okay, this portion is a public hearing, so I'll just start on my right over here. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak on this issue? On the left? Yes, sir.
Cash incentives to business or industry. Should Alamance County be in the business of granting cash incentives to business or industry? How will it affect me as a taxpayer? These are always the questions that arise when incentives are discussed. If the SAMIC request is granted, will it help or hurt the economy? Will it help our county? We need to look at the facts. SAMIC has been in Mebane more than 25 years and employs about 160 people. If this expansion goes forward, SAMIC will add approximately 50 or 51 jobs for a total of about 210 employees. Reports state this will raise the county's tax base to $85 million. What does 50 or 51 well-paying jobs mean to our county? It means there are 50 or 51 families that will more likely have health insurance, buy homes, and patronize other businesses. I don't see 50 or 51 jobs. I see 50 or 51 families. The number of jobs created is misleading as it affects many more people. One fact that does not escape me is that SAMIC has been in Alamance County for 25 years. They have proven to be a good corporate citizen. They have contributed to the tax base during this time and actually helped keep my property taxes lower. One fact, whether we personally like it or not, we have to recognize that this is a new era for recruiting and growing our tax base. Each request has to be considered on its own merit. In the past, our Board of Commissioners has scrutinized each request and made what I feel were wise decisions. Quite often, many counties and local governments spend a great deal of money recruiting new business, often getting into bidding wars. They fail to see that one way to grow the local economy is to work closer with local business, the local business community, and grow local existing businesses. I encourage you to vote yes for this incentive package. Thank you for your time.
What's your name, sir?
Stuart Smith. And I'm not related to anyone at SAMIC. I don't propose to be employed there, but as a taxpayer, to me, this is a no-brainer. Whoever negotiated this deal, I think you should be working with the Department of Commerce, because those guys in Raleigh need some help.
Thanks, Stuart. Anyone else on the left like to speak?
Chairman, Commissioners, I'm Tom McGowan. I'm Chairman of the Economic Development Committee of the Chamber of Commerce this year. You're used to a little stronger spokesman. Dick Shirley had this title for over 20 years, so we miss him, but Dick did a great job with it. I just want to echo a couple of sentiments that have already been expressed. These are very good jobs. I would maybe correct one thing Mr. Barber said. He said they, describing the benefits, he said they were sort of standard. Those were very, very good benefits that I saw listed there. This is a substantial investment. This is a return on that investment for the community. A lot of us have different ideas about incentives. We're, none of us, I think, are big fans of them. The fact is they are a weapon that is out there, and they will be used against us. Whether we like them or not, they're there, and they are a fact right now of the political and economic landscape in this community. So we certainly like the fact that each of these requests is looked at carefully. They need to be. They need to be scrutinized. We feel that this is one that certainly, for what this community is getting, for what Sandvik has brought as a corporate citizen, is fitting. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good morning. I'm Paul Kuntz. I'm a lawyer. I practice over on South Church Street in Burlington. And in my free time, when I'm not raising my three kids, I volunteer some of my time as Vice Chair of Economic Development at the Chamber of Commerce. And one of the reasons I do that is, much like Mr. Smith, who spoke before, I think that the jobs that we bring through economic development have a much broader impact. Take a look at the county's budget and the amount of dollars that get put into social services and schools. And I think that those 51 families that benefit from those jobs have a much broader impact on our economy than just the tax dollars, just the spending that they will create. I think that families that have a member of their household employed and is not on social services, who has a job to go to and sets that example for their families, those kids are going to do better in school too. So when we talk about investment, I think this is an investment in our community. We hear a lot about incentives in the press. We hear a lot about incentives at the state level. Most of my clients are small business owners, and when you start talking to them about that, they say, you know, you kind of wince when you say incentives. But when I talk to them about investment and how far that investment goes in the community, every business owner understands that you have to put the money in up front in order to have a payoff. And of course, the way these work is as there's benchmarks that Sandvik will have to meet. The other thing that struck me, two other items, in the budget and in the presentation, there's a lot of discussion about, you know, that real property owners are now bearing the vast majority of taxes in the county because the textile industry is essentially evaporating. We don't have an equipment base. The personal property tax is dropping. The type of investment, it's not just the 51 jobs. It's the money that's being put into the equipment that will pay off over time. Last thing I'll say is that competition, just looking at those maps up there, sometimes we think about competition as we're competing with Greensboro or Raleigh or Winston-Salem for something, but in this case, we're competing even internally within that corporation against all their other locations, and that's a global competition that we're in. I think as a county, this is just one of the things that we need to do, is to make sure that we are part of that competition, and incentives let us do that. I want to thank you for your time. I encourage you to vote in favor of this incentives package. Thanks.
Any other comments?
Yes, sir. Chairman, according to the agenda that I got, I didn't get any numbers on the package. Is there some?
They just had them on the screen. Oh, you mean the dollar amount of the incentives?
Yeah. What is asked of the county?
That's a $1 million incentive spread over 4 years. As they reach certain benchmarks, and incentives will be paid. If not, the incentives will not be paid. Any other comments or questions from the audience? Okay, if not, the public hearing is now closed, and we'll get a motion out on the floor. I will move approval of the request. Is there a second?
Second.
And there's a motion and a second. Okay, is there any discussion?
I'd like to just, with all due respect to Sandvik and people who are in favor of this process, the statement was that it's a no-brainer to give cash incentives. It's, with all due respect, it's not a no-brainer to a lot of people. It's also a brainer that you don't do it with a lot of people. One variable that's not mentioned in this whole process is, would they have expanded had the incentives not been put on the table? Number one. And I can't say. I don't know that they would tell you. Our chairman said that they didn't mention about moving somewhere else. I'm in favor of infrastructure incentives that will benefit surrounding companies and businesses that will come in and possibly hook up in the area, satellites and so forth and so on. But we constantly hear this phrase that we're going to get it back within a certain amount of years. What we're going to put out there, we're going to get it back. We're not getting anything back. We're getting the taxes that are due us for the expansion, for the equipment, for the building. We have given $1 million in cash. And the only thing we're going to be getting back is the taxes that are due us. This county is in the middle of the state. We're on two interstates. We have all the water anybody could ask for at a fairly reasonable rate. We also have all the labor that anybody could want at a fairly reasonable rate. High wages aren't demanded as much as you might see somewhere else. And our tax rate. We had an incentive package not long ago where a company was threatening to move to the Research Triangle Park and leave our area. And I just found that astounding that I'm supposed to think that it's a no-brainer that somebody's going to leave here paying 50-some cents per $100 and go somewhere where they're now paying $1.04. I mean, excuse me, 99.8. You know, I just find those things to be interesting. But as far as cash goes, I just will never support them again. Now, I have voted for cash in the past. I've had to stomach it. I've had to literally, you know, they say hold your nose and vote for something. You know, 232 years ago, this country was founded or created as a result of a handful of people rebelling and taking it upon themselves to do what we need to do. I don't think there's a member on this board that if they could reach over and cut off the switch for cash incentives in this state and or nation, that they wouldn't reach up there and pull the switch down if they could cut it off immediately. We all say that it's something we have to do, that everybody else is doing. Well, in my personal life and professional life, I've always felt like I don't do what everybody else is doing just because everybody else is doing it. I feel like I have to take a stand. We think it's going to come from the national level if it's ever going to be addressed, or from the state level if it's ever going to be addressed. I'll assure you that it will never be addressed at the federal level and or the state level until there's enough local protests, whether it be the citizenry or whether it be members of the board. If we have an opportunity to cut that switch off, we ought to do it. But it appears that there's not enough support to do that. I think it's an excuse to say it's a game that we have to play. No, it's not. I just don't think we have to do anything except what's moral and what's ethical. And I honestly believe that it's a slam to other businesses who have never come and asked for anything, who will never come, and companies who are here who have hired and employed hundreds and thousands of employees over the decades, and they've never gotten a single penny of incentives. But with all due respect, I'm glad Sandvik's going to expand here. Good luck to you. But I'm taking my vote and reach up and try to cut it off I wished others would, but.
I'd like to make a comment.
Sure.
I had every intention of making a motion for Mr. Sharp, beat me to it, to move this public meeting to July 21st, because that would be an evening meeting, and perhaps more of the citizens could come and hear the presentation and have a voice in this process. Also, another reason for asking to move it was in the last meeting, Commissioner Sutton requested or asked if we would have information concerning Sandvik, and he was assured that we would have all pertinent information prior to this meeting. In my packet, I had no information. Only thing I knew was what was in the newspapers. So I don't know if you want to amend your motion or, okay, Ann had her say and we'll move on. I don't know what you intend to do. I wish Sandvik well. I am from Ebon, and you are a good corporate citizen, and wish you well. See what happens.
Let me say something. I am appreciative of Sandvik wanting to stay here, and I support this 100%. I think the only way that we can expand our base is to give incentives. And any time that you can give an incentive of $1 million over a period of 3 or 4 years, and you're going to get back per year, I figured it up, on 58 cents on the 100, it's $4.6 million a year is what Sandvik is going to be paying in taxes. And to me, anytime a company can get that kind of incentives, and the county is going to make out with the amount of tax increase that we're going to, that the taxpayers are going to see, it's a win-win for the taxpayers, because there's a lot of homes that would have to pay a lot of taxes to bring in $4.5 million. And I'm going to support the motion.
Before we vote, and I appreciate everything we've said here, Bill, and I'm trying to be nice about all this. I would like to say, though, the process of how this was done. I can't, for the life of me, understand how we can go negotiate a deal. I suspect that if my intuition is correct, and I believe it is, that people walked away from tables in Mebane knowing what was going to be put out there on the table. I would bet everything I've ever had, which isn't much, but I would bet everything I've ever had that the sentiment there was, we've got the votes for this. And that just bothers me terribly, that our government works this way. I mean, it appears to me that in business sometimes things take place, no holes barred, everything's okay. You know, it's just business. And that's okay. But government to me is a different situation. I can't imagine that this took place the way I believe it took place without the board being involved. Even if it was generic, even if it was just a generic reference as to the expansion, we've got a company in Mebane. We met on Honda in closed session, and we discussed, well, I'm not Honda, but the other company that was going over in Mebane, we discussed it. It was put out there as to what we wanted to do, what we would, you know, be willing to vote for, possibly. The company was mentioned. And I'm just stunned that this deal took place the way it did. You know, it's just paramount to, it's the same as, in my opinion, if the pastor of the church went somewhere and negotiated something on behalf of the church without having no idea of what his deacons wanted him to do, or the congregation. I've said it before, civic clubs are operated a little more on the up and up than what I'm seeing in these processes. And I just hope, going forward, with the next deal that comes along, with the next chairman that we have, that the board will be treated respectfully and advised of these things before they take place, and seek counsel, seek advice, and act accordingly. But I just saw this as something that I could not have been a part of.
Okay. Have any more comments?
The economic incentive packages that have been passed by this board, particularly in the last 4 years, have been extremely successful, each and every one. As a matter of fact, I understand that we've got some folks that would like to do a presentation, Mr. Smith, and I think it might be something we might want to see in the future. And when you look at this particular incentive package, I think it's the best of all of them. I really do. When you look at the equipment, the land, taxable up to maybe $80 to $85 million. When you look at the jobs, when you look at the benefits that the people are going to receive, it's just a win-win situation. This is what we need here in this county. And you know, when you look at Alamance County and compare it to other counties, in regards to incentives, John Locke just ran a very interesting article, Tim. I don't know if you saw it or not. Talked about the amount of money per capita that counties spend for incentives. And Alamance County, it has 60 counties that this professor compared, and we were like 42nd out of those 60 counties, between $3 and $4 per capita that we spend. And I think Randolph was something like $14 and Davidson 16. They were way on up there, just to give you an example. So we really hadn't spent that much on incentive packages, but the ones that where we have passed these incentive packages, they have been extremely successful. And again, Amy, when you look at what SAVIC's doing here, when you look at this package and what they're bringing in, I think this is going to move them to what, to number one or two as far as taxes for businesses here in Alamance County. We're looking at them, they'll be up comparable to GKN, if I'm not mistaken. Is that a pretty true statement, Amy?
And they've been here 30 years.
Yeah, been good, just outstanding corporate neighbors. So again, as far as cash incentives, I know where you're coming from, but
we just went up a couple of notches.
I understand that. But
and in jest, on my dashboard of my car, and I won't say another word. Let's go on to another topic. But I will say, John Locke Foundation did put out an article last month against cash incentives.
And that article was against cash incentives. Yeah. Yes, sir, that's true. But looking at the figures, what we have done, we have been successful. And we need to continue those endeavors if it brings good jobs here. And it helps, and that helps, the folks that are paying property taxes, that's going to help keep their taxes low. Definitely. So certainly we need to look at them. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Well, when we read in the press that our unemployment rate spiked to 6%, I got word this morning that another manufacturing in Alamance County was going to close its doors. I think I heard that passed along. Then we need to do everything in our power to keep an industry that is doing well, can expand in China if it wishes. I think it prefers to stay in Alamance County. But to me, we need to do this. We just did a incentive package for Honda. We didn't do specifically to Honda, we did it to the airport authority, but it benefits Honda. I think we're only being fair to an existing industry in the county to give them an incentive package, whether it's cash or what. It's only being treating one like we treated the other. And I think with their business, which is growing, this may not be the last expansion we see out of SAVIC here in the county. So I think we have a wonderful opportunity to keep SAVIC here, and I think this incentive package is relatively modest compared to the investment they're going to make. So any other comments from the board? We do have a motion in a second. Call the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
The motion passes 3-2. Thank you.
Okay.
Next on the agenda, we have performance budget. Jim Burke.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, good morning. Several meetings ago, the board instructed the staff or requested that we gather some additional information on the issue of performance budgeting. So we went to the expert in this area. Today, we have Professor Bill Rivenbark with the UNC School of Government here today. In your packet was an article that he wrote. He has extensive experience in this area, has worked with other county governments on this, and so he's here today to kind of explain about this topic, what it is, how you would implement a program, some of the more detailed information, and to take any questions that you would have regarding how this program would work here in Alamance County. So at this time, Bill Rivenbark.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, thank you for giving me this time this morning to talk with you briefly about performance budgeting, and please call me Bill as we go through the Q&A. You do have an article that I did write that I am going to refer to in just a minute or two, but before I jump in to performance budgeting, I want to back up and let's put this into some context here. I went to your website and I found your mission statement, and I think it's a very well-written mission statement who put it together, that Alamance County will provide excellent services for the safety, health, education, and well-being of the public. And what struck me was the word excellent. And how do we measure that here in Alamance County? I moved on down and looked at your vision and values. We focus on results, where each of us knows the level of customer satisfaction, our response time in delivering these services, and the cost of those services. And again, you know, how, when we focus on results in local government, how do we measure those results? And how do we know that we're getting a return on our investment through public investing public resources? Private sector, they do that with a profit margin. And of course, we don't have that profit margin here in local government, so we turn to our performance measurement systems to give us information back on the efficiencies of our operation and how effective those operations are. Now, what I'm talking about here, I want to start with performance measurement and say a few things about that before I move into performance budgeting. One thing I really want to iterate this morning is I'm not talking about anything new. Performance budgeting has been in the United States since the early 1900s when the New York Bureau of Municipal Research was pushing it. And I will say this, the state of North Carolina is one of the leading states today across the nation with the level of performance measurement systems in our local governments across this state. We have a high level of professional government in this state, as you know, and with that, I think, comes performance measurement. Now, what is performance measurement? Well, it's the idea of looking at your departments and your programs, what you're providing, and for each department and our program, identify a mission statement. Why does that department or program, what's the purpose, why does it exist? Look at service delivery goals, look at quantifiable objectives, how are you going to measure those successes, and then look at a handful of performance measures. Now, I'm talking in abstract terms, so if you will turn with me to page 31 in your article, you will see a box there that I put together for the Durham County Building Inspections Program. Actually, it's a split program. It's consolidated between the city of and the county of Durham. And you will see this particular program, Building Inspections, and you'll see the information that makes up a performance measurement system. You see your mission statement there, to provide a cost-effective level of service and so forth. You see several goals in place of what this program is up to. Quantifiable objectives, and I'm looking at that second objective right in the middle of the box. Review 90% of all residential plans within 4 working days. Quantifying the goal of to provide accurate and prompt plan review. Not just with anecdotal evidence, but with quantifiable information. And then you see your measures there, percent of plans reviewed in 4 days, and then percent of planned errors found in the field. One measure here that I would prefer, I don't see here, they may have it, is cost per plan review as well, to give you some feedback on efficiency. I am not saying we take this information and just pull it over and drop it into Alamance County, because we have a process that we take your departments and programs through to create this infrastructure of performance measurement. Some of it may be the same, but some of it may be based on your individual needs here in this county. 4 days may not be the right time frame. 3 days may be the right time frame, and so forth. But this is, gives you an example, when I say performance measurement, what I mean here. Now, we do not have a chicken and the egg problem when it comes to performance measurement, performance budgeting. The first thing you have to have in place is a well-managed performance measurement system out in your departments and programs, and those managers using that information for making all sorts of decisions. And when that occurs, that puts them in the place then what I would say is to move into performance budgeting, which will allow your department's program, county manager, so forth, and ultimately you make some decisions based on performance. I'm not talking about eliminating your line item budget. We'll always have a line item budget. That's what reconciles with our financial management system. That's how we pay bills. But what I'm saying is, let's supplement that line item budget with this performance information to allow you to make some decisions along the way based on performance. Will you sit here and make all your budget allocation decisions based on performance? Absolutely not. You know, there's politics that get involved sometimes. There are fiscal constraints that get involved. But when this stuff flows through the process, we have an organizational culture shift where the focus comes off the line item adjustment of 2%, and it starts putting your focus on our outputs, outcomes, and efficiencies, and trying to make more decisions based on that. Quick example, you mentioned Davidson County. A while ago, I've worked with them for the past 5+ years on implementing their performance measurement system. It had some problems once the system, the performance measurement system, got up and running. Realized they had some response time problems with EMS in certain zones of the county. The commissioners responded to that performance measurement system and actually invested some additional resources in a particular area of the county to help reduce those response times. Casebook example right there of performance budgeting, allocating that additional $100,000 or whatever it was in that particular, not because on the anecdotal evidence that we're busy, but here are the response times that's unacceptable to us to get to those individuals and needs. So just an example there. Let me talk just a little bit about implementation and kind of resources needed to move this forward. This is something that you do not just jump into overnight. And performance budgeting surely does not occur overnight. You have to step back and start looking, I would suggest, in a county this size, thinking about my work in Davidson County, thinking about my work in Rockingham County, who I've been working with very closely here. I'm probably talking about a 3 to 5 year process. Over time, where we start small, we start with volunteer departments and programs, let them start creating their performance measurement system. We offer some of those services there at the School of Government, where we can come out and help you with this transition. I prefer quality over quantity, and let each department program really get focused on what they want to do, and over time bring on more departments and programs, so you build a good system from the beginning. And I think that does take 3 to 5 years. I also think sometimes it can take an investment of some additional resources. In Rockingham County, I talked with the board there, and they did decide to invest in a budget performance analyst position for 2 reasons. One, they wanted to build in some internal capacity here if we were going to do this right and do it over the long haul. There's a lot of local governments around this state I could talk to that's done the same thing.
This position would not only help your departments and programs create this information, but most importantly, and this is the, if I leave you with nothing else, don't just collect information, use the data for making decisions. And there's a big difference with collecting the information I just showed you with Durham County and actually using it to drive decisions. And I think that's where an investment of resources can occur as well, to helping departments and programs develop, but more importantly, analyze the data and use the information for making good management decisions, and also can bring you good information as you deliberate among all your services that you have to provide, and constantly looking for those efficiencies and effectiveness as we go forward. So let me stop there. I can continue to talk on this subject for another probably 2 hours. Nobody would probably appreciate that this morning, Monday morning, but I'm capable. So let me pause here and take questions.
Did you help set up the Davidson County?
I did. We did.
I brought the Davidson County scenario here several months ago, and one of my buddies over at, I won't say buddies, but a person who works in a department here in our county, he provided this article, and I passed these out, I think, two or three meetings ago. In the Davidson County article that I had read, said they had saved roughly $1 million or something. Can you explain?
Yes. Davidson County, that was a great undertaking, and I think it's just been a win-win. Moving forward here, what they wanted to do is give something back to the departments and programs for moving into this. It's this idea, you give me more accountability with this data, department, program, and I'm going to return some flexibility. And what Davidson County has done, if a department or program meets its goals and objectives with quantifiable data, and there's some budgetary savings left over at the end of the fiscal year, again, most of those budgetary savings, as we know, fall into fund balance, and that's how we build up fund balances from year to year. But now they are letting the departments and programs carry a percentage of that amount that would normally fall into fund balance and take it over with them for the next fiscal year for a one-time expenditure. They can either invest in capital, or they can give out one time, and we don't use this word very much in local government, but it's becoming more used, is one-time bonuses. That we're going to give our employees more of a stake in the game. Now, we're just not going to let them get a hold of their budgetary savings by leaving positions open. If they meet their goals and objectives, we'll allow them to get some of those unused dollars. And a lot of the departments there have not opted for the bonus. A lot of them there are using it for one-time expenditures and improving their capital. Information technology is a good one that a lot of the departments and programs have been using the money for.
Would this allow a county manager to go to a department and, I mean, in business, you don't really have many departments, in my opinion, come to say, well, this is all I could do. You know, they might give their suggestions, this is what I can do, or this is what we think we need. But then the CEO will say, well, you're going to do this, or we're going to replace you, or we're going to find another way to get. Does this allow people to have more oversight of what a department claims they have to have as far as personnel, how many people it takes to work so many accounts, and so forth and so on? Does it allow a little more hands-on?
It does. I think it does give departments a little more flexibility in managing their departments. But again, when we give that flexibility in how they use personnel and move personnel around, but we've got to have something in return, and that's documented performance. I do want to also broaden up just a little bit, too, as we could talk about the specifics. This also represents an organizational culture shift as the kind of moving the county forward. And I don't want to leave anyone to believe, though, that you're not going to lose the ability, the oversight, where, you know, it doesn't relieve the manager and the assistant manager of those normal responsibilities, but what you are telling those departments and programs is they're going to have to take on more responsibility here when it comes to efficiency and effectiveness. And I'm going to give you possibly something in return for that as well.
One last question. What's the cost scenario for Davidson County? How much did it cost to implement it, or is there a cost?
Davidson County, they actually did not have an assistant county manager at the time, or was maybe it had been a budget director. I can't remember. One of the things that they did do there was to hire, I think, a full-time budget director to not only help with the performance stuff, but help with the budget in a whole. As far as the dollars it cost contracting with us at the School of Government, it was very minimal. You know, $2,000-$3,000 or something like that. I mean, that was the minimal side. I think the cost side has been on the time that they have actually invested in this. But I believe if you were to ask Davidson County, they would say they have recouped that.
Oh, sure.
You know.
And you're available for the same.
Absolutely, we could. You know, and we have some counties, cities calling us. I'll go out and do a one-day training if that's going to occur. We may not even charge for that. It just depends on how complex, how much involved would you like the School of Government, and that depends on. But we do not charge private sector fees from the university.
The department was understaffed with this.
It absolutely.
The need for additional personnel.
Yes, and going back to Durham County, when they're trying to turn around 90% of all residential plan reviews within 4 working days, and if they're not able to do that, you know, what is going on? The inputs and outputs have not aligned. The inputs being staff, the outputs being the residential plan reviews, and something's not right there. That requires you starting to use the information. Now, is it just kind of a blip on the radar where this is only a one-year occurrence, or has this mismatch been going on for the last 2 or 3 years? And when you have that scenario, I think you have a prime case of the department or the program of building inspections making a good case for another FTE. But again, grounding that request in some historical performance data rather than we're busy. Yes, great question, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions? Tim, is there...
I guess the question is, where do we go from here? If the board is interested in us moving forward with this, I guess the first step is that we would need the assistance of the School of Government to help us come up with a game plan as to how we move forward with this. I guess the first step would be that y'all would approve for us to contract with them to come up with a plan, come back to y'all at the future for you to see what the plan is, if it's going to require additional staff resources, or whether we can take care of it in-house with the staff we have, or whatever. We could come back with that plan at some point in the future, and then for y'all to sign off on that plan and for us to move forward. That would kind of be the step for today and to move forward beyond here.
I'd like to ask him one more question.
Yes.
Government does seem to do things different than private business. Does the School of Government or for instance, you and your arena, do you try to compare statistics with personnel and job duties in the private sector as far as what it takes to get the job done in the private sector versus what it takes to get the job done in the government sector?
Well, I heard two different things there. As far as going out and doing personnel comparisons with salaries, benefits, and things like that, no, we do not make those comparisons. But we do make comparisons when you're looking at a building inspection function in one county or city compared to how they're performing in another county or city. The problem with trying to make that comparison to the private sector, very few services in local government match up with those private sector. I mean, we're more into public goods where they're dealing with private goods. But I think this element of benchmarking that you're talking about can be very valuable when you want to compare yourself to something like a Davidson County or Rockingham County. But before you can make that comparison, you have to have the infrastructure in place. to make that comparison.
Does government ever look at the private sector as to how they get things done? Or?
Yes. I mean, that's not my background as far as in the private sector. You know, things like total quality management and some of that that has come out of the private sector has found its way into local government. And I guess if you talked about information technology and very specific processes, yes, we could find evidence where we have looked into the private sector. But the problem is those processes don't align very well.
Well, they never will.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't even line up county to county. The government. Good. I'm willing to try it myself.
Okay. As Tim mentioned, they need staff needs direction on what we like to do. Sounds like an interesting concept to me, as it does Tim.
I'd like to make a move. Motion.
Okay, we have a motion to proceed with the
second.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you, Jim.
Can I tell a story, one story about the private sector? I'm a big circus fan. I'm a member of the International Circus Appreciation Club, Circus Historical Society, and I used to take my family all over the East Coast to see circuses. And I know it sounds corny, but we did it. It's a great family. But the Army Corps of Engineers one time, this is a true story. Circuses, the people who work for a circus are so methodical that they can put up a giant tent, put up a performance, pack it up, be on the road at night, put it up in the next city the next day. And they do this 10 months out of the year. And I can't cite you when they did it, and I can't show you anything in print, but the Army Corps of Engineers supposedly talked to the, went and sat and watched how they did things. To see, you know, what could they learn from the process, and they took it, you know, tried to, you know, bring it over into the government sector, because they were, you know, the private sector was clearly in that arena was clearly doing stuff that some people thought people in the government sector probably couldn't do for various reasons. But that actually took place. Wish I could show it to you, but I remember reading about it.
Next on the agenda is the appointment of tax assessor. The appointment of the tax assessor and tax collector. Kim?
I'm getting old, folks.
Good morning. I stand before the board this morning to request reappointment as Alamance County's tax assessor and tax collector. But before I'd just like to go over some of the highlights of our department in the last few months. Our revaluation certainly is ongoing. We have completed the review of properties in Graham Township and are currently reviewing the final value reviews of Burlington and Pleasant Grove Townships. In September, we will be presenting to the board our schedule of values for the board's approval, and we will have a final recap of the project in January of 2009 before we send notices out to taxpayers. We've also collected our first amount of tax dollars through the debt set-off program. We've received $7,164 from the Clearinghouse Agency. That was in May. So I look forward to the amount of money that we may get in the first quarter of 2009 since we do have this up and going and it's proven effective. And then finally, as I make the annual settlement report to the Board of Commissioners and to Amy, I do believe that the board will see a slight increase in the collection percentage, which is a big accomplishment given our staffing and software issues that we've experienced over the past few months. I'd like to thank the Board of Commissioners for the opportunity to serve the citizens of Alamance County over the past 16 months and look forward to the month ahead. If it so be the pleasure of the board.
All right. Let me ask you a question, please.
Yes, sir.
Did you provide this to the other commissioners, possibly?
No, sir.
Okay, I think they'd like to see that. I'm going to ask that this be copied and given. Sure. But one question, where you show fiscal year 2009-10, three comparisons, reval 20%, reval 40%, reval 60%, what are you saying there?
Those were just some numbers you had asked that I provide, giving you some type of indication of the revenue neutral tax rate given what percentage our revaluation property values will go up. And it's real because we've only done so few reviews, just Graham Township, and we've got a lot more of the county to final review. I was just providing you some different examples of what could happen depending on the valuations.
Right. Okay.
Yes, sir. And yeah, I will forward a copy to the board members.
Okay. I didn't mean to put you on the spot with that, but I'm just trying to get an answer to that question. Thank you for the information.
Yes, sir.
Revaluations moving along smoothly?
It's moving along. It has its bumps, but it's moving along. It will be completed. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. What is the evaluations of the property? I know the homes are selling for about 10 or 20% less than they were a year ago. Is that going to be reflected in the values of the
Yes, sir. It will be reflected, but what you have to remember is we're looking back at 2001. So what were the property selling like in 2001? And, you know, it may be a decrease from last year, but is it a decrease or increase from 2001? So remember that last revaluation date.
So your base is 2001.
Yeah, we'll be comparing our 2001 values to our new 2009 values. Yes, ma'am.
Hey, do we have a motion to reappoint Kimberly Horton
for
another 2 years?
So moved.
There's a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
At this point in the meeting, I'm going to have to leave and ask Dan to take over. I would like to, with the board's approval, if there's a motion made on the facilities presentation, I do approve of that. The board decides to move along with the recommendation to borrow the money for facilities upgrades. On the resolution limiting the provision of health services, I would vote against that. I feel like we shouldn't do anything to limit health services to people. I don't want them spreading around something that other citizens could take, and I think it's a human thing to do, to treat people if they need it. So I would be opposed to that motion.
Are these votes? I mean, they're not voting.
He can't leave and tell us how he's going to make a difference.
That's how I would vote. So
there's no vote.
Take it or leave that.
We appreciate your advice.
Have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, well.
Next order of business is the facilities presentation by our assistant county manager, Tim Burgess. Tim.
Mr. Vice Chair, members of the board, as you recall at the budget retreat on April the 10th, our facilities director, Richard Hill, did a presentation of the condition of many of our facilities, and that at that time we were just wanting to bring that to your attention and receive some guidance and direction from you as to where we go from there. At that meeting, I think you requested us to come back to you again, maybe with a proposal and a plan of how to get these buildings repaired. So Richard's going to come at this time, and he's going to, you'll notice that the dollar amount has increased since the last time that we did the presentation. There were some, Brian Haygood with Parks and Recreation had done as part of his presentation, he had talked about the condition of some of his facilities. So we've added those in, plus some other facilities that are in need of repair also. So Richard will come at this time, and he will actually show you some additional slides of the other facilities, and we do have the presentation that was given to you before. We do have that available if you have some questions about some of those facilities, but we will not be going back through all of those slides again. So Richard, if you'll come at this time.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
As Tim mentioned, back in April, I think I hit you up for about 175 slides of information, none of which was pretty. The buildings that we were trying to address really encompass everything minus the new jail, to be quite honest with you. We have a lot of mechanical needs, some electrical needs, a lot of systematic problems that have developed over the last couple of decades. We won't go back unless you request and revisit all that we went over last time. I would, however, like to start with the old courthouse and take a look, because it is from a financial standpoint, a very large piece of the pie of the $10 million that we're asking for, approximately $4.5 million. Before we start that, I want you to understand where those numbers come from. Back in 2001, the board asked Mayor Phoenix to do analysis of that building. And they came up and presented a very thorough analysis of the building at that time. We've simply taken those numbers and extrapolated cost increases every year of 5% and come up with the numbers that you have now. Okay. With that said, a little visual representation of the courthouse. Probably the overwhelming problem at the old courthouse has to do with water penetrating the building. And it's penetrating in two different ways. One, when it rains from exterior walls and roof lines, and number two, from hydrostatic pressure, that being the pressure underneath the building that's forcing water into the basement. This is an example of water coming in the courthouse through either the walls or the ceiling or the roof line. Complete deterioration of the walls. This is an example of what happens inside of a 90-year-old structure using an existing boiler system. This is what was once a condensate line, that being the water taken out of the radiators. Those condensate lines are embedded into the walls of the courthouse. They've eroded to the point where there is no metal left. Therefore, when you turn the existing boiler on and heat that room or anywhere in the courthouse, water runs down the internal part of the wall and can exit anywhere. Your guess is as good as mine. We've taken off some of those radiators. That's what they used to look like. Put in some new condensate lines. And with Mr. Smith's help, refurbish those to what they used to be like. However, understand, this is just the radiators. All the lines that support this, whether supply or exhaust, have eroded and are in awful shape. We have got to get away from using the boiler as our primary heat in that courtroom. Pretty sad shape of affairs for a judge's chamber. Very cramped, no technology, ill lighting, no closet space. Probably getting happy to go to the restroom. The courtroom itself, extremely dated. To function correctly with the demands put on that system now, a lot of integration with technology needs to exist or to be brought up to speed. One of the things we've looked at is the ceiling and the roof line. The roof is actually caving in under its own weight. That and water damage. An extensive replacement is going to be necessary. There is no patchwork that can fix this. Several decades ago, we covered the windows in an effort to reduce noise and eliminate some of the heat gain and loss that we have in the building. We uncovered one of these to take a look, and working through some architects and some engineers, took a real look at what would be necessary to actually make the courtroom function again in its natural light. It is doable. It can be done working under the guidelines of the Historic Preservation Group, where the exterior of the building will look exactly the same, and you can eliminate the noise and the heat loss and gain in that building by using proper insulation. The carpet is literally to the concrete. This needs to be completely ripped up and redone. Going back and looking over time, what we have found that these floors were actually tile in its original state, and when were concreted over some decades ago, and now put carpet on top of them. Another example of the ceiling falling. Basement, hydrostatic pressure. This is where you keep your records. The water is literally coming in the building. Again, talking back with Bill Moser from Moser Mayor Phoenix, Lucian Routon, who's in attendance today, other engineers and architects, this is probably going to require a complete redoing of the basement for waterproofing, which means you've got to excavate all the way down. There's no easy fix here. This is what water does over time. Painting it isn't the answer, obviously. That's the lowest point in the basement. You can see the water literally being forced into the room. Walls coming apart and leaching throughout the building, specifically on the second and third floor in the basement. Up on the third floor, there literally is a room right above. Tim, remind me, I think this is right over the jury room, where the ceiling has now completely come apart. We got rain yesterday. If you want to, after the meeting today, run over with me and you can consider the color of water that's sitting in the floor. That's what it's going to look like. I don't even have to go over there. That's every time it rains. That's your hole. Your roof is completely gone. Leaching in your library. Water comes in over your ceiling tiles on your drop ceilings. Again, into your library. Some places over the decades have actually been worked on and they didn't even go through the effort of putting the walls back. Probably because the problem wasn't fixed. Sit in that building, you can't get warm in the summer. 1970s air conditioning. Very inefficient, no fresh air per code. Zero coming into that building. Lends itself, Ms. Vaughn, I know you've asked from time to time about mold considerations. That's one of the primary reasons you would have it. Any questions about the courthouse?
Talk about excavating. How far down would you have to go?
All the way. Just like we did the old DSS.
I mean, 10 feet.
Well, I don't know the exact points, but I would imagine you're talking about 10 feet. Tammy, 10, 12
down
feet?
To the footings.
All the way down.
Which means moving the steps out of the way and blocking off and going down to the
footings. When was the last time this building or any of these buildings have been inspected? Because here we come back with, you know, $10 million, and I know I'm jumping ahead of you. But this should never have gotten to this point.
Courthouse is a disgrace.
It is.
It's a disgrace.
You'll see a line item, Ms. Vaughn, for approximately $2 million for the excavation. That's probably the trickiest point to estimate. We don't know, and you won't know, until you spend a tremendous amount of money, have an engineering group come in and do a thorough analysis. But based on conversations with architects and engineers, that's a pretty close estimation. It probably would demand that all four entrances into that courtroom be removed. And then it's got to be put back in a historical proper manner. That drives the cost.
Okay, you talked about the boiler was outdated, no doubt. When was this building built?
1923. The boiler was actually replaced around the year 1998, I believe. The boiler is not the problem. It's all the lines carrying the heat to the radiators and the condensate coming away from it. That's all embedded into your internal walls that you can't get to unless you rip them out.
Are you going to do something like HVAC?
Yeah. What we would say here is that you would bring the building up to code with fresh air requirements. Your boiler would probably not be used at all. You would go with a gas pack to heat the building.
You don't have that cost here?
Yeah, that is.
Am I missing?
That would be in that $4.5 million. That would completely take out all the systems in that building and replace them with requirements that would be necessary by today's code.
On the engineering part for the excavation, and I mean, is somebody going to analyze that as to whether that's necessary or not?
We would have to bring to you on a separate issue the okay to go forward and actually hiring someone to go give us a step-by-step cost analysis of what it would require. These are estimates based on the last time you spent money for that and using a little bit of common sense on the escalation of price. And I also built into there that we knew this was about a 3-year project. If you gave us the okay today and we got started with an engineer, by the time they engineered and drew up plans and we had this work done, we're probably into 2010 at best on getting that building done if you started right now. Prices will continue to go up.
Let me say on the courthouse, when I started as manager, that was one of the projects that I took on myself and have with Richard, who is an engineer himself, his leadership, and Sammy. We've done some work over there, just kind of patchwork. We've changed all of the water lines out to the street. We've done some work on the radiators within the building itself. Like he says, the lines leading to them are just corroding and whatever metal does. I've held court myself in 51 different counties in this state. And like Commissioner Sutton says, this is an absolute disgrace. And it just takes so much time to get this building into shape that it's imperative. We either decide to do it now or it's going to crumble. We're going to lose that building, and it is absolutely gorgeous building. You stand back and look at it, and the way the sun shines on that building sometimes, it is absolutely beautiful. So, and it's you know, it's the gem of the county. It's got to be saved.
We spent $1 million to do the terracotta up at the top. And
that's right.
Did
that's
we do
right.
any roof work then?
Yes, we did.
Yes, so we did.
The roof was put on. Is that absolutely?
Well, why is it leaking?
It's not. I don't think it's not necessarily the primary roof. It's all the stone and everything around those walls that have never been reworked, and all that water is just coming into the building. It's going to take a complete analysis of what's up there. You're going to have to run all your lines. A lot of the stuff you can't even get to. You can't see it. You can't put your hands on it. It's a complicated issue, and that's why it's going to take spending some real money and spending some real time to try to work this out.
Yeah, that our courthouse was designed by the same architect who designed the one in Greensboro, Smithfield, and Fayetteville. Fayetteville, I know, it was terrible when I held court there. They have redone that courthouse. Smithfield, which looks just like ours, only it's a little larger. They've totally redone theirs. What did it cost?
They did it in stages, but it was several $1 million over time, and then they annexed a building beside it.
Guilford County, they've already redone theirs. We were up there for a meeting not long ago, and they have transformed that courthouse. On the outside, it still looks like the old courthouse, but inside, it's very modern and it's very efficient. Most counties who have courthouses this old or older are having to do the same thing. The building process back in the 20s when this was built just won't last, and the mortar in between a lot of these stones is just being eaten away.
The building itself is sound. You know, you don't see cracks. You know, the original tile in the hallways is still there. It's amazing. Very, very sturdy. You go to Smithfield, as Mr. Smith was talking, the same materials were used, the same railings, the same tiles. You walk in the building, you close your eyes, and the feel of the building is exactly what you have in Alamance County. It's just that the internal systemic problems with the building have to be addressed.
I've never been a fan of deferred maintenance, and do we have a line item for this in our budget?
Preventive maintenance?
Yeah.
We've tried that. Richard has it. We've tried it, and we continue to try it. And, yeah, Richard's whole budget almost is for preventive maintenance, but it's patchwork. All we can do is patchwork.
We address it in a couple of different ways. We've used the facility funds. The commissioners have been nice enough to give us about $500,000 a year over the last few years. Most of that went to work that was either preventive or to take care of necessary items. That money is gone. There's nothing left. My budget for this year on any product to be or any service to be hired, any materials I need to purchase is just over $200,000. You start cutting that up into 12 months, into 20 buildings, you kind of get the idea that there's not enough money to solve any of these problems.
I'm gonna make a statement, and I don't know if anyone agrees with me or not. We need a line item for maintenance. And it should take priority over new spending.
Well,
otherwise, we wouldn't be in the predicament we are now with the court.
One of the things we tried to address this year was Mr. Smith asked us to put together a CIP, Capital Improvement Project, looking at 5 years.
Right.
And departments came back to us for help. We did that, and we forwarded that to all of you. The problem is not getting the return on the money. Every 590 account we asked for was taken out of the budget. That was a lot of the preventive maintenance. That was your roof, some of your roofs. That was new air conditioning systems that Department of Register of Deeds wanted, people like that. It's going to take money. And when you look at what large companies do, private sector, if you take a look at what governments do, they spend 2-3% of the value of these buildings in preventive maintenance every year. We're not doing a fraction of that, nor have we done a fraction of that for decades. And
we're past preventive maintenance. We're at the point of emergency, and get these buildings back in shape, and at the same time set up a totally encompassing preventive maintenance program. But right now we're past preventive maintenance. Preventive maintenance will not do us any good at this point. We've got to refurbish these buildings.
I mean, the building you're in right now has problems with water leaking in the ceiling. And I gave you the estimate, if you look back in your slide, where to replace the roof on this particular building, I estimated around $35,000. The estimate to repair the brickwork that's already been damaged is $150,000. This is not pay me now, pay me later. This is pay me now, pay me five times later. And that has caught up with us. Band-Aids no longer take care of it.
Well, we need good management on this.
This is not a problem that just cropped up yesterday. Okay. This is something that I know 35 years ago when I walked into that courthouse, there were problems then, and it's just an age thing, and it continues to be problems, and we're going to have to fix it.
There's smart ways. I think if you look at what we did at Central Permitting, for some $35 a square foot, you took an old building and you converted it into a very nice building. That's what we had to be doing. Now, obviously, the courthouse on a grander scale. Any other questions about the courthouse?
Is the terracotta on the building in good shape?
Relative. The problem with the terracotta stuff is it's very difficult to clean. You can't sandblast it. You pit it so bad. There's special cleaning process you go through. But structurally, the building seems sound.
Well, the only thing I would hope that the engineering firm that comes in and looks at the foundation scenario. I mean, do we have enough faith that they'll tell us we don't need to do it if we don't need to do it?
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. But the fact that you've got water coming in, it's hard not to address.
Yeah. Well, I understand
that. And you have to get to the problem.
Now you take, and I don't hang around the bathroom down the stairs, but I've been going downstairs to courthouse for years.
Yeah.
And the men's bathroom, in my opinion, has not really gotten any worse. It's just the way it's always been. So,
right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's, and I think Ann's question is, you know, we've never let our schools get this way. I mean, we've repaired our gym floors when they needed to be, and and we just let county buildings go for whatever reason. I've been asking myself for carpet in that courthouse for years, and never got done.
Well,
never
I think, Commissioner, you've hit on it a couple of times that whether you're talking government on a federal level or state or local, that infrastructure is falling apart. Whether you're talking highways or you're talking buildings. And I don't think it's unique to this county, but I think we are behind other counties on addressing the problem. And as Mr. Smith said, your past making simple changes here.
But I do believe 5 years ago, if somebody had given us the condition of that courthouse, we would have put the money out there, and now we're going to be paying triple.
Well, one thing I would also, I personally would like to ask the commissioners, a picture is worth a thousand words, but being there means something else. Anytime any of you would like to walk through any of our buildings, we would love to take you, show you the things that are good, but also show you the things that need to be worked on.
And we need a hard hat.
In places, probably, and a willingness to get a little dirty.
Well, I think this is a wake-up call for all of us, and if this is done properly, there's savings from such diligence.
The other thing I would also like to remind you of this, we spend a tremendous amount of time taking care of problems. David Anderson, our plumber, is here today. With the rain like we had on Sunday, he'll spend all day today and tomorrow getting water off of top of buildings. That's time that he should be spent taking care of other issues. And this department is very dedicated to trying to provide the service to the people who want it. But keep in mind, when we're off doing these other things, we can't get to the day-to-day rigors of the county. Parks and Rec. And Brian's here, he can speak to any of this. A lot of this is driven, the costs here are Cedar Rock Park and Eli Whitney. We'll talk about Cedar Rock Park. A lot of this is driven by parking and age of buildings. Wellspring parking, and we'll talk about parking a lot here. There's nothing paved out at Cedar Rock. Now, that's two issues. One, when you have foul weather, you've got people walking in rock and mud and dirt. But number two, you can't control parking by having it lined out. So one of the things that Brian will talk to you about is when he has a large event, he has 200 or 300 people down there, people are parking everywhere. And they don't always park where they should park, and they tear up grounds. And you can see, I think this is one example Brian was telling me the other day, that people park on both sides of the street here, and you actually can't have flow of traffic. Because again, nothing's lined out. Brian, I think you mentioned to me 130,000 people a year at Cedar Rock Park.
That's correct.
This is the addition some time ago that are bathrooms. This little building is falling apart. I mean, it's falling down. Foundations are giving way. Again, additional parking required. Water's coming into these buildings. Doesn't do any good to patch that. It's going to be back the next time it rains. These are self-evident. Curtis House, Brian, if you want to say anything here, but just a lot of renovation work required.
The historical structure from late 1700s, part of the historic buildings on the register at Cedar Rock Park. So.
And probably the biggest issue here, parking, Brian, the building's in pretty good shape?
Yes, building's in good shape. This is where we relocated our administrative offices last year. It's worked out great. Would be ideal to be able to have some paved, marked parking. All our traffic now coming for whatever purpose is coming to Cedar Rock Park.
You also got the issue of a slippery slope there coming into this building.
Yes.
That makes it really tough when it's raining.
Yes, it would be more minimal for handicap accessibility. Also.
Eli Whitney, a lot of conversation over the last few months about what to do with this building. Let's start this conversation with understanding the building is sound. I know there's the political nature about what the community may or may not want to do. The building can be salvaged if that is what's right for the county. A week or so ago, to make sure that we were looking at this with benign eyes, we had the school system come out. Johnny Rogers and his group came out and spent some time with us, and we wanted to make sure that they were seeing the same things we were. They were. They agree totally that, this is the boiler, for example. If you want to see age, let's see if we can get to it here. Well, this is the basement where they hold bingo, which has now been removed. And by the way, this is probably not worth the trouble of going through and trying to renovate these basements. Brian has already moved these activities to other facilities, and the cost of going down and making this ADA compliant because of the stairs far exceeds the benefit. It could be used for storage of rec supplies, county supplies, but probably not for personnel use.
You folks remember a while back, Ms. Bailey came, addressed the board about concerns about ADA and being able to access these spaces. We've since been able to work with the volunteer fire department area and get access to the old fire department, where they've moved into a new one. So the senior citizen type programs, dances and things of those nature, have been moved to the fire department, which is all one level, much, much more amenable. What we're looking at doing the building now is to be able to facilitate the athletic programs that we do at Eli.
So you've decided not to even entertain further the Beaver Jordan?
No, we haven't decided that. I did go meet with the school system, with Mr. Wall, and we had a lengthy conversation about Eli Whitney and other options that I talked about with the board, the possibility of looking somewhere else in Southern Alamance County to build another gym if the choice was not to renovate Whitney. Their recommendation was just what we prepared for their staff to come down with us and get a real true picture of the existing problems. I can tell you, is it even worth fixing? And everyone seems to agree, structurally, it's fine. It can be renovated. No one yet has taken off the table the option of going somewhere else and building another facility. But I think that was probably key for me to be able to tell you it can be repaired. But we haven't gone to the Beaver Jordan site at this time and actually examined the property. The school system's inclination was work with us to get a good judgment on this.
This is the entry into the basement on one side. And again, there's all kinds of ADA problems here with using this and trying to bring it up with code. The fact that the ground level is about 3 feet off the floor in the basement means that we would have to go down to get into the building. You've got water issues. It would be very problematic. Same thing with going up into the stage area behind the gym. To gain access to this for the elderly or for ADA would be incredibly expensive. That's what you have to go through. The floor itself, very good shape. We have come to determination by modifying some expansion joints and by a special process that the school system is now using in their gyms. This floor can be refurnished without having to sand it. It's been sanded so many times that the oak is now worn. But we believe it can be refurnished, resurfaced, and probably gain 20 years of work or use out of it for a minimal amount of money without having to take it all apart.
How about the boiler?
The boiler itself, we'll get to that in just a second if you can hang on. The boiler is a mess. The old metal windows need to go, obviously, single pane. They draft air. There's lead paint in them. There's all kinds of problems. That can be replaced for minimal amount of effort. The boiler, ancient. Mike Vale, Tim O'Malley last year in a fit of emergency when we lost the boiler, stole parts, spent time on the internet, made up parts, you name it, to make the 1954 boiler work. This is what it looks like. And this has to go. There is absolutely no way anyone could put any kind of dependence on that boiler coming into next year. No way.
We've closed two winters in a row for its fate. Things have been able to resuscitate, but it's just been pretty miraculous.
Yeah, it took, Tim, remind me, but I think you and Mike there were for 4 days, about 12 hours a day.
Yes, absolutely.
Just trying to get it up and running. That's all.
So your renovations here at Eli Whitney would include
new heat.
Heating and air conditioning.
Heating and air conditioning. Air conditioning probably only in the office area up front and perhaps the back where you'd want to hold functions, not in the gym itself. Unless you so want it, it can be done. But it does drive cost. Brian, you want to hit on the air conditioning requirements of the gym or what you think it would be needed?
Well, the key for us is the heat, because we're primarily using, now we do use this gym every day. It's open every single day except Sundays, and it's used a lot for open gym for people coming in the evenings. But it's generally cooler. It does have big circulation fans that work well. We've looked at the possibility of being able to open up some of those windows alongside the gym. It'd be great. It's we get into our basketball season for you starts 1st of November, and we play through to about mid-March. So when it gets down about 20 degrees, if we lose heat, we're closing down. This is what happened last year. It's very, very difficult for us to find space for those teams that use the building now. So I would tell you that the heat would be the priority, heat, floor, and roof. That's the big three here as far as we're concerned.
Okay, Brian, is the Eli Whitney building primarily being used or will be used for the youth and not the elderly that had made it their home?
Well,
is that where we are?
That's kind of what we're looking at. The quilting bee that's been down there for approximately 80 years, it will continue to use this building if you desire to fix it. But the ongoing programs, we have bingo programs a couple times a week for senior citizens. We have lunches, pop-up lunches, we have exercise classes. Those things we would have already started relocating down to the Volunteer Fire Hall.
That worked?
It has. We've moved bingos and the line dance class down there. The bays inside the fire department are large enough to handle our numbers, and it's a benefit because it's all one level. They're not having to navigate any steps, even the ramps or anything, to come in front of the building. So the fire department's been very gracious to work with us. They had told us that they were interested in using the old fire department for a community center anyway, and this is kind of dovetailed in. So.
Some of the controls that Tim and them worked on last year, and just a tell-all, I guess. You can kind of get a visual of what we're talking about. That's your coal pit left over. So we are going back a little ways. And these are all just self-evident pictures of what we're dealing with. Restrooms that need to be redone, obviously not ADA compliant. And parking. Quite a nice setting down there. I think spending a little effort on the grounds, replacing some of the gym equipment, and coming in and paving an entrance into the building and having a small parking lot would go a long way. Right now, it's kind of rocky. You have to be careful where you drive and how fast you go.
Okay, another question. Of course, we can't predict the future, and I know that. But asphalt paving, and that's primarily composed of?
Well, a lot of petroleum-based.
Is this a good time, or can we foresee in the future where petroleum products will decrease in price?
The good time was last summer, and it's only going to get worse unless you got something we don't have about petroleum coming down.
In
the case of asphalt, it's not just the product, it's the transportation of the product and everything else that goes with it. And the quotes,
so no crystal balls,
the quotes
here
that we gave you on this analysis were good for 30 days. I can guarantee you they're higher right now. That was in April. They're probably 10%, 15% higher.
Oh, I'm sure. Petroleum based, yeah. So, we don't know. Just a question.
Well, that's kind of the end of the presentation. Unless you want to go back and look at that myriad of things that we looked at. You're shaking your head now.
He doesn't have to pay for it.
Yes, he does.
Any other questions? We have a staff of people here can help address.
A lot of this work is as far as plumbing in these different buildings, not just this one. Can it be done by your staff?
Some of this can be done by staff, but the majority of this, no, because you're talking complete renovation work. You're going to have engineering drawings, seal drawings. You're talking pretty extensive stuff.
Licensed plumbers and so forth. Right. Are your people licensed?
Yes. But you're going to need more than one.
We're required by statute on most of these projects to have engineer or an architect or both.
Will that go out to bid?
Yeah, they'll go out to bid.
No, the engineers and the architects.
They don't have to go out for bid, but it'll be up to y'all.
I'm getting ready to touch on that.
After we do this, what will the state, well, all this aside, let's just because it's going to take years to do a lot of this. Okay. All this aside, what's the state of our buildings?
Your heart and your liver is working good, and your face still needs to have a facelift. Nothing. We can spend this $10 million, and the average citizen or commissioner can walk through these address these buildings from the outside, and you'll see no difference. We're taking care of HVAC. We're taking care of electrical. We're taking care of plumbing. We're taking care of interior needs specific to the courthouse. But outside, walking down the hallway of this building, so there's nothing in there that's generically driven as far as aesthetics. There's nothing in there about putting wallpaper up. There's nothing in there about extensive lighting changes.
Ongoing, from today forward, what will you need to keep it status quo?
You need that $10 million baseline, and you need a very well thought out CIP program going forward to take care of the needs based on growth that this county's experiencing and the age of the buildings.
And that's something, the ongoing maintenance that we can look at as next year's budget process. We come back with numbers as to what we're going to need in each year's budget to maintain these buildings like they need to be maintained. Not only these, but the rest of the buildings that the county has also. But if we were to make these repairs, get the buildings where they need to be, then the plan would be that we keep them maintained on a yearly basis and that we never have to come back again with a large project like this again that's done on a yearly
basis.
One
quick comment. I know I think we all knew this was going to be a long meeting, so I'm not worried about shortening it. We've got to do what we've got to do. This never happens again 20 years from now, 30 years from now, or whoever's going to be sitting up here 20 years from now. You know, down at Duke, when I used to take Susan down there all the time, I saw they had all these flat roofs. So I called the maintenance people and I said, how do you maintain these? He told me, he said, if you put $2 a square foot, is what he said, because we know what a square foot for a new roof job is now. He said, if you put $2 a square foot, that's the way they had it figured down there, into your total roof system, every year you'll never have a major repair job.
Yeah.
That's what he told me. Now, is that scientific? I don't know. But he seemed to know what he was talking about.
Well, the roof we replaced at old DSS, we used something called HydroStop, and you're welcome to come out and look at it. A very, very good system that you do not have landfill costs because you don't have to take the old ceiling off. You come back with a textile membrane with rubberized on the top, has a 10-year guarantee, and all it takes at 9 years is to hire them for a few thousand dollars to re-roll it, and you have another 10-year guarantee.
What did you do over that system? Social services.
That's exactly what I'm talking
about.
That's
the one you're talking about.
That's the Hydra stop.
I saw that yesterday.
That's what we've recommended. The great thing about that roof also is this, is the effect of its percentimicity, how much it lets the heat go, so it keeps your cost down.
What'd you pay for that job over there?
Remind me, buddy. $20,000 or so. $20,000 for that, and that's a 17,000 square foot building.
Okay. Don't go too far. Hey, some more technical questions. Let me talk about the administrative end of this real quickly. The prices, you had these in your agenda packets. These are very similar to what you had at the budget retreat, and I'll tell you what's been added to this. This goes through a list. It breaks down in some detail for each of the facilities what we're looking at wanting to get done. When you go to the last page, if you look at Parks and Recreation, those were the ones that Brian had mentioned as part of his budget presentation at the budget retreat, but we didn't have numbers on that at that time. That's been an addition to your previous presentation that you heard. The other thing is HSC space utilization. We're in the final stages. We've had Lucian Routon, who's here today, do a space utilization study for the HSC building to see if by repositioning departments or people within that building, if we could both make it more efficient for the users and for the employees, and then also hopefully gain some more space in that building. So we're in the later stages of that. If we are to make those changes, then there's going to require some refitting to the building, and so we've put some money in there for that, which is the HSC space utilization part there. And then also we put in some miscellaneous amount just to cover any cost overruns. That comes up to a total of $10 million. The reason $10 million is important, one of the reasons is that if a local government borrows no more than $10 million within a calendar year, then they get what's called a bank-qualified loan, and the bank actually gets tax breaks on loaning the money to the local government. That's why we're able to get such a low interest rate, is if you borrow no more than $10 million within a calendar year. If you go over that $10 million, the interest rate's still good, but it's a little bit higher. How do we pay for this? Let me back up. One thing about the prices here, we would love to have exact prices for you. The only way we can get exact prices for you, and the way we gathered these prices was they're either architects' estimates, staff's estimates, or we actually went out and got some quotes. We didn't bid them out, just got some quotes. The only way that you can actually get exact prices is when you go and request bids from the contractors, and those numbers come back in, and you have three or more bids, and you choose the best bid. That's the only way that we'll have exact numbers. So how do we pay for this? If we were to borrow the entire $10 million, then the loan amount of $10 million, the interest rate I got a couple of months ago was 3.85% for a 20-year repayment period. You're looking at $721,500-some per year. Now, that number, the 3.85%, may have gone up some since then. Even if you go all the way up to 4.29%, you're still looking at yearly annual payments of $750,000. So even with an increase possibly in the interest rate, we're still looking at $750,000 or less to borrow the money. What process do we need to follow if the board chooses to move forward with this project? Here's a timeline. What we're looking at today is that the board approved for us to proceed with this project. The second part of what we'll be asking for today is for the board to allow us to go and select an architect, because there is a lot of design work that's going to have to be done prior to actually sending out the bid packets. Engineering drawings, architectural drawings will have to be done, and so there's a lot of that work, and we'll need their assistance in providing the packets. If you approve that today, what we'll do is move forward with issuing requests for proposal to the lenders of the money in October. We'll come back, we'll receive the proposals from those lenders in October. We'll come back and have the board approve borrowing the money based on whatever we get back from the lenders as far as those proposals go. We'll come back to you in November. We'll go and seek local government commission approval, which we hope to receive that in January. We'll close on the loan in January. At that point is the point at which contractors feel comfortable going to all the work that they'll need to go to in order to submit a bid. So at that point in January, we'll actually solicit construction bids from the contractors, receive those back. Once we get those construction bids, then we'll bring those contracts to y'all for you to approve. So at that point, we'll know how much of that $10 million that we're actually going to have to use for this project. That we do not need, we'll return to the lender. Okay, so at that point, we'll have the exact numbers of what we need to do, what we'll need to actually use for this project. Again, the board will award the construction contracts in March. Construction will begin hopefully in April, and then the complete renovations with everything will hopefully be completed in December 2010, with the courthouse being the longest project. Most of the other stuff we've got to do can probably be done in 6 or 9 months. That'll be the one that's going to take the longest time. Let me go back to the selection of architect. There were two resolutions in your packet there. General Statute 143-64.31. As a general rule, when you're selecting an architect or selecting an engineer or have design services, you're supposed to send out a request for qualifications. Not a request for bids, but a request for qualifications, where they basically submit their qualifications back to you. They can submit an hourly rate, but that's not required, and we're trying to see who the best architect would be. Once that comes in and then we choose the best architect, then we start negotiating a price with the architect, because when you're doing these kind of projects, you want quality first and price is second in these things. You have to get the best architect possible. The statute does allow for a county to exempt themselves from going through that first stage, where we go through a process of sending out requests for qualifications, getting those back in, choosing the best qualified, and then negotiating a price. The statute does allow under Section 143-6432, under two situations, for the county to exempt themselves from that process. The first one is that the county can pass a resolution that says that projects where the design fee, architect and engineering, is going to be $30,000 or less, that they can do a blanket resolution that says with all of those projects that we're exempt from having to go out and solicit qualifications, that we can just choose an architect or an engineer. We've got a lot of projects, or several projects, where the architect fee may be $5,000, $10,000, or an engineering fee may be a couple thousand, that we need to go ahead and work on that project, and the money's in the budget to do the project, but instead of having to come back to y'all each time, we'll have the authority to go ahead and hire the engineer, the architect, and move forward with the project. The second situation is that projects that are over $30,000, the board can pass a resolution that says, with the following listed projects, that we're going to exempt the county from having to go out and get the qualifications, and we're going to go ahead and choose the architect, and then we'll negotiate a price with the architect. And those two resolutions are actually in your agenda packet for you to hopefully approve today. I want to talk about the resolution that we've put in there that deals with this project. If you look in there, and it's a longer resolution, but what we've done is we're looking at the courthouse project, which we're going to need an architect to actually oversee that entire project. The old DSS building, we're going to need an architect to oversee that entire project. And then most, if not all, of the other facilities we've got, we're going to need some assistance with design work and with preparing bid packages, but we're hoping to actually handle a lot of that by contracting that out to others. The long resolution requests today that you approve that those projects be exempted from having to go out and seek qualifications, and that you agree today to hire the firm of Routon, Nicholson, and DeLuca Architects to be architects on those projects, and I'll talk about them in just a second. We have added one more project to that list, and that's the Pleasant Grove Recreational Center. We're having to do some work now because of the fire. It's requiring some design work. The architects already begun working on that. The reason that we're wanting to go ahead and hire, we've picked the architect we want, we've chosen them, and it's based on the following. Of course, the architect that I mentioned, they did the EMS center, and we had a very good working relationship with them. The new EMS center came in within budget and came in on schedule, and they were very good to work with throughout the whole project. At least the time I was here, I felt like they were looking out after our best interest with that project. When we were dealing with contractors, that they were always looking out after our best interest, that they came up with solutions that would save us money. We've had them doing some preliminary work on the courthouse and in the old DSS building, and we've worked on some other projects with them. We always feel like they're looking at it from a practical standpoint as to how we can do this, do what we need to get done, but also do it in a practical manner that will save us money in the long run. We have a great working relationship with them. We feel like that they would look out after the best interests of the county if we were to choose them as the architect. What we'd like to do is for the board to adopt that resolution, which would exempt those projects, and also agree to go ahead and contract with Routon, Nicholson, and DeLuca to be the architect on those projects. We will be glad to then bring back a contract to you for the architectural services that we'll bring back to you in a meeting in August for you to actually approve the contract, but allow us to go ahead and start working on that process. I do have the architect, Lucian Routon, is here today. If you do have any questions for him, most of y'all have met him before. We did put his brochure in your agenda pack if you look at some of the other projects that he's done. very much shows the qualifications they have and their ability to handle these projects for us.
Thank you, Steve.
Yes, sir.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, I'd like to ask about the financing situation.
Yes, sir.
Do we have any equity in the bonds that we now owe? I mean, the bond indebtedness that we now have to add this money to that. There's a rule that says that you can redo it up to a certain percentage of the original without voter approval and so forth and so on.
That'll have to, I'm not sure. Mr. Smith may have an answer.
Yeah, we do have. It's our total bond debt indebtedness, our old bond. It's about $60 million.
It's more than that. I'm thinking maybe about 86.
86 million. We have some.
We'll be able to borrow the money at anywhere close to 3.85%.
I doubt seriously if bonds are going to be any cheaper than that. And it's a longer process. And even with that program you're talking about, and we looked into that, Commissioner, you still got to have your bond attorney who's out of New York. The cost, I think, and the time is a lot. I can't emphasize enough. We've got to move on this.
And I understand that.
I'm sorry, but it's just something. And
we
looked at the bond.
Bad decision, though, because of
right. I understand.
Bad decisions.
We spent a lot of time on this.
The 20-year debt service.
Yes, sir.
Why not 10? I mean, I think it's excessive to take $10 million in 20 years. That's a total payback of $17.4 million. That's a 70% interest. Yeah.
We can do it in 10.
We can do it in 10.
What 10-year debt?
I don't know if I have those numbers with me. I can get those numbers. The reason for doing them 20 is to try to have the yearly payments as low as possible so that that our budget would be able to absorb it as easily as possible. And that's the reason being. We can go 10.
Well, I think you'll see that the 10-year probably not a whole lot of difference.
I'm sure it's over $1 million. Not sure how much. Guessing probably.
I'm talking about the payment. I mean, you're saying
that's right. One probably, if you're looking at 10 years, $10 million, I'm guessing, you know, $1.2 million may be a reasonable number.
I'd rather pay that than go 10 more years for $700,000 myself personally. I mean, it's just
we're
15
fine.
Versus 30 years.
Right. We're fine either way. However, y'all would like for us to do that. And what we could do when we send out the request for quotes from the lenders, we can have them do them at 10, 15, and 20.
So we're not obligated to
take
20.
No, sir. What you'd be obligating today if you did is to move forward for this project. We're going to borrow the money. When we come back at November for you to approve the lender, we could come back with 10, 15, and 20-year numbers that you could approve whichever package you wanted, loan package at that time.
Take all the profits from Sandvik and pay the payment.
Well, you know, it's kind of like we're in that situation. What was it? The commercial said, you pay me now, pay me later. We're paying the later right now to get things straight. Well, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the two resolutions that we see here, plus we proceed with the projects and the selection of the architect.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Next item on the agenda is the resolution limiting provision of health services. Commissioner Lashley.
As everyone knows, we have a real problem in Alamance County with illegal immigration. We don't have a problem. I personally don't have a problem with immigration. The problem I have is illegal immigration. And all this resolution is asking is the employees at the health department and the social services abide by the law that's written on the federal level to make sure that those people receiving any kind of benefits from the taxpayers just obey the law that's on the books. We're not asking for any special things except for just obey the law. And this is a three-page resolution. I didn't want to get into reading it because it'll take about 5 minutes. Does anybody have any questions?
We could get our county attorney, assistant attorney, to comment on it. Is social services incorporated in this amendment, this resolution? He said it was. Paper said it was.
This is directed to the I think to all county employees, the way I understood it.
They refer to Medicaid too,
and
would have to.
It,
Yes, it begins with the Medicaid.
We tried to make it cover all.
Okay, good. That's what I want.
The citizens of Alamance County has told me, and I'm sure the other commissioners are hearing also, that you know, they don't mind people being here legally, but you know, they don't like to see their tax money going to people who have already broken the law and are here for whatever reason. You know, if they've broken the law coming here, then the taxpayers don't want to fund them being here.
Any other discussion?
I'll make a motion that we approve this resolution.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion approved. All right, next item for business, the county manager's report.
Yes, sir. Commissioners, I have several things. First of all, we have two new department heads. I don't think you've met them yet. Stuart Keller is head of purchasing. Stuart?
He just left.
He had to go back to work. David Leonard is our new fire marshal. Is David still here? David?
Yes, sir.
If you would stand up. David came to us from Greensboro Fire Department. He was highly recommended. I think several of you know him. He knows all of the fire chiefs in the county. He's worked with them, and I think he's going to make a great addition to our staff. Thank you, David.
Sir, welcome aboard.
I had talked to the chairman earlier about canceling the next meeting. For some reason we had so much on this meeting, and looking ahead, it doesn't look like we have enough for an agenda at this point. Just let me advise that the meeting may be canceled before next time unless something else comes up. August, I'm sure, is going to be a pretty busy month, but the July 2nd meeting, we usually cancel one of the meetings around this time in the summer anyway. But there were so many things going this weekend. We'll just let you know in the very near, between now and the next meeting date, whether we will have it or not. At this time, commissioners, there are a lot of things going on. I would like to ask the board, if you would, to go into closed session to consider personnel matters pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11a6. You'll need to make a motion.
Do I have a motion at this time that we're going to close session? Discuss personnel matter. So, do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say pop, say aye. We're now in closed session.